Welcome back. Next topic is exponential function. So in this topic, what we will see is, first we will identify with some known terminology, that is exponent. We have already seen this exponent, where we allowed integer powers, and then while defining the exponents, we allowed rationals also. So when we defined exponents, they were of the form a raised to r, and we always assumed a is greater than 0 and r belongs to set of rationals. Now I want to define an exponential function. So as the name suggests, exponential has to do something with the exponent. So what we are doing here, when I am considering a function of this form, I am raising something, some number, to the power of a, where a will be popularly called as base, and r is the exponent. So this is base and this is exponent. Now if I want to define exponential functions on real line, then it is mandatory for me to define this a raised to r for r's that are not belong to set of rational numbers. This is real line minus set of rational numbers, that is, I am talking about set of irrational numbers. So I don't know as of now what is the definition of exponent for set of irrational numbers. Okay. The next question that we have seen is, why is a greater than 0? That for which you know the answer. Let us say a is equal to minus 1. And if you raise a is equal to minus 1 to the power half, which is a rational, sorry, not a is equal to minus 1 to the power half, a is equal to minus 1, and let us say a to the power half is defined, then minus 1 to the power half will give me a complex number I, which belongs to complex set of complex numbers, but I don't want to deal with complex numbers, so I am avoiding a to be greater than 0. In general, you can define a to be a negative number and then deal with complex numbers. We don't want to indulge into that conversation, so I don't want to define a to be less than 0. So a less than 0 is eliminated. Now the question is, a is greater than 0 and r belongs to irrational, where r belongs to r minus q. What will happen in this case, or how will I define the rational number? To be precise, let us ask a question, that is, can I define 2 raised to square root of 2 or 5 raised to pi? Okay. So in this case, there is no direct way to answer this question, but I will definitely have a strategy, which is a calculus based strategy to answer this question. Let us consider this pi, and the value, the numerical approximation of pi is, actually we all know pi is an irrational number, and 3.1459265... and this thing is non-repeating, it will continue till infinity. So now what I need to understand is, from what I know, can I define the number 5 raised to pi? So anyway, I cannot define it accurately right now. So based on my understanding, I am asking you a question, that is, 5 cube defined? If so, then next question is 5 raised to 3.1 defined? So what I am doing here is this. If yes, can I define 5 raised to 3.14? Now you remember, all these approximations are actually a rational approximations. 3 is a rational number, 3.1 is 31 by 10, which is again a rational number. 3.14 is 314 by 100, which is again a rational number, and I can go on like this. There is 3.141 and so on. So if I continue this way, I will reach somewhere. I will reach somewhere, and that somewhere I will call as 5 raised to pi. So in principle, I can actually define a raised to irrational number. This you will study when you will study a topic of sequences, which is outside the scope of this syllabus. So we will assume that you have to trust me on this, that 5 raised to pi is well defined. In a similar manner, you can do an exercise for 2 root 2. So root 2 is actually 1.41 and something, something, something. So again, you will go with 2 raised to 1 is defined, 2 raised to 1.4 is defined, 2 raised to 1.41 is defined, and so on. And you will reach somewhere, that is 2 raised to root 2. So this way, we are very clear that a raised to x is defined for x belonging to real line. This sets up the platform for defining an exponential function. This is very important. A raised to x is well defined for x belonging to R. This answer is given by convergence of sequences, which is outside the scope of the syllabus, but we know that it exists for sure. So I am guaranteeing the existence of 5 raised to pi. Existence of 5 raised to pi is assured. In case you are interested, you can take a basic course in analysis or calculus, where you will study these things. Okay. So now let us go to the let us recall all of these laws you already know. Simple laws of exponents. Earlier we knew the laws of exponents for only rational numbers. Now we are talking about the real numbers. So S and T are real numbers. A and B are greater than 0. S and T will play a role of exponents. A and B will play a role of basis. Okay. So then it's very easy to prove. You might have proved A raised to S into A raised to T is A raised to S plus T. Remember, here product here is becoming addition here. These are crucial points. A raised to S, the whole raised to T is equal to A raised to ST. So a raised to operation is becoming a product here. AB raised to S is A raised to S into B raised to S. Good. And then obviously you need to know that 1 raised to S is always 1 for every S belonging to R. A raised to minus S is equal to 1 by A raised to S. You can also write this as 1 by A whole to the power of S. A raised to 0 is always 1. Remember, where your A is always greater than 0, because 0 raised to 0 is undefined. Okay. So with this understanding, we have revised laws of exponents, which we will use the left and right. So you better remember all these laws. And therefore, we are ready to set a framework of exponential function. So here is our definition. An exponential function in the standard form is given by f of x is equal to a raised to x, where a is greater than 0 and a is not equal to 1. This is a new condition that we have introduced. We have seen why a should be greater than 0, but here they are saying a is not equal to 1. So this needs further analysis. We will analyze it in due course. So right now, if you look at the values of a should be greater than 0. That means all these values are allowed. And a should be greater than 1. That means all these values are also allowed, barring the values 0 and 1. So the first from the definition, the first observation that you can figure out is, because you have barred the values 0 and 1, the function f of x is equal to a raised to x will have a domain which is entire real line. For every x belonging to R, we should be able to compute a raised to x. Okay. Then let us analyze, this is the observation, why a is not equal to 1. A is not equal to 1, let us put a to be equal to 1. So f of x is equal to, let us say, 1 raised to x. But from the laws of exponent, what you know, 1 raised to s is always equal to 1. Therefore, 1 raised to x will always be equal to 1. In fact, it is nothing but a constant function. I am not interested in handling a constant function, right? It's nothing but a horizontal line. Y is equal to 1 is the graph of a function. I am not interested in this. So let us not call this as exponential function. That is what we are saying in the definition. So henceforth, we will never talk about a to be equal to 1, a to be equal to 0 or a negative number. So if you have a real line, you will have an expression of this form where you are talking about this interval, open interval, and this interval, which is an infinite interval. So you have two characterizations, which is 0 less than a less than 1 and a is greater than 1. These are the two characterizations that you got over this thing. Now it will be interesting to use some graphical tool and see what are some functions of this kind look like. So here is an exercise that I will give you. Use some graphing tool like Desmos and plot these functions together. For example, you plot the functions given in 1 using Desmos. You just put fx is equal to this, fx is equal to this and this, and plot all these three graphs together without any understanding about the behavior of the function. You plot all three of them together. Then use the second graph and put all these three things together. Identify the properties of the graph, that is, through which points they pass through, is there any difference in the graphs of 1 and 2. So identify all these properties like we did in polynomials. And after doing that, again return back to this video and we will see some of the functions that are given here by a graph, and we will analyze those functions. So right now you pause the video, come back in the next video.